comes from executive producer Lilian Garcia.
Every athlete is on this quest. Every performer dives in
head first,
battling real life challenges and overcoming obstacles in an effort to make their dreams reality. Singer, songwriter, 15-year WWE host Lilian Garcia was the first woman to ever announce WrestleMania.
And the first to launch her own podcast,
which gives you an all-access pass to the human interest stories of elite athletes
and extraordinary entertainers.
Now, let's embark on another fascinating journey
of chasing glory
with your host, Lilian Garcia.
Happy Monday, everybody, and welcome to Chasing Glory. And if by chance you're not listening to this on a Monday, well, happy whatever day it is that you are listening to this. Just welcome to Chasing Glory. It is great to have you. Thank you so much for following me at Lilian Garcia on Instagram and Twitter, and also Lilian Garcia official fan page on Facebook, for following the show at Chasing Glory Podcast on Instagram, where we post a lot of things about Chasing Glory. And also for getting the show everywhere, that is subscribing, reviewing, rating the show. I love that you guys are checking out the show on Apple Podcasts and also so many other areas, including the Chasing Glory app, whether it's Spreaker, whether it's Spotify. Just keep spreading the word, because I love the fact that, you know, I actually get these emails that show me all the people that have been subscribing. And I have to tell you what I do. I open the email, and I'm talking hundreds and hundreds of people, and I scroll through every one of them, and I thank you guys. Literally, as I do it, I'm like, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Because I want you to know how much I appreciate that you are listening to this, how much I appreciate that you are following the show and you are spreading the word, and these, you know, amazing stories that our superstars are sharing. It is where it gets really real, raw, and inspiring. And last week, as you know, we had Lacey Evans on. I knew this was going to be impactful, because obviously I was there. I got emotional even while she was sharing her story. You guys couldn't see, but I was even getting emotional. And so many of you responded saying that you were listening at work and you were a wreck and you were crying. And yeah, you know what? It is one of those stories that really, really, really gets to you. But I love that she shared it, and she felt really good about the response that you all sent our way, really, for both of us. Thank you to Lacey for opening up so much. And I know that there were a lot of you that were saying that it has impacted you. And for anybody, again, suffering from drugs and alcohol, please seek help, because it's not only ruining you, but it's ruining the family members around you. And there is nothing wrong with asking for help. We all need help of some kind, one form or another, at some time in our lives. So please, and if you can help someone, if you can be the one helping, then please do that as well, because you're going to make a huge impact in this world and to everybody that that person touches. So thank you, Lacey. We have a big show ahead, but first I do want to get to the review. All right, so the review of the week, and also, guess what? The winner of the month. So as I've told you, if you go on Apple Podcasts and you write a review and you make sure that you write some kind of way for us to get a hold of you, if you do that, then if you get chosen for the review of the week, it gets read on the show, and then that gets put into a drawing, and then my team just draws out a name, and then you get the winner. And then the winner gets an autographed 8x10 from me and also a t-shirt. Yay. Okay, so the review of the week comes from Paul Lee Chap. He says, "Real, raw, and inspiring is the thesis of this podcast, and it definitely holds true. Lillian is a warm, easy-to-talk-to individual who is able to get guest stars to easily open up about their real-life struggles with chasing glory. There's a raw feeling to the interviews, and the guests feel comfortable opening up to Lillian because of her kind-hearted nature. You get untold stories and exclusive first-time reveals in the eye-opening stories told by the heroes you grew up idolizing. This podcast is highly recommended for everybody because there are so many life lessons that you can learn from hearing other people's stories, which inspire you to become the best version of yourself in life. Thank you so much, Paul. I'm telling you, this is making me so happy because that is the goal of the show, is through these stories to help each and every one of you. It also helps me. We get to help each other. If we hear each other's stories and we hear each other's struggles and we find out, how did you get through it? Well, okay, that's a good idea. Let me try that. Then it's also like, we're in this together, right? We're not so alone dealing with all of these things that life keeps throwing at us. And it does, but hang in there. And somebody that has definitely, before I go on. So yes, congratulations to Paul. You are in the drawing and my team has, let's see, I'm shuffling these around. I'm just going to pick somebody from the hat. All right. Okay. Here we go. The winner is, I think I read this a couple weeks ago, Christy Thomas. All right, Christy. Thank you so much for your review. You have won the t-shirt and also the autographed 8x10. And somebody from my team is going to be reaching out to you so we know how to mail it to you. So congratulations to Christy. Keep those reviews coming. Okay, so speaking of someone that has had challenges, but someone that is just really inspiring. Have you been watching her lately? Just so cool. As we continue to celebrate and close out the month of Women's History Month, I wanted to close it out with none other than Dana Brooke. So I'm very, very excited about this. Dana has been wanting to be on the show for quite a while, and I've been wanting her to be on it, but I also felt like it wasn't time yet. It just wasn't time yet. So I kind of waited. And then when I saw what she did with Rhonda, and I've seen how real she's become, right then and there, I said, that's it. I got to have her on. So I contacted her and she right away was like, heck yeah, I want to do this. So today you're going to hear a lot from Dana Brooke. You're going to actually get the behind the scenes as to what led her to go against Rhonda, how she got the news, how she found out about everything, how she reacted, her family, everybody, how her arm is doing. Holy moly. Not sure if you saw Rhonda kind of went AWOL and just wouldn't let her arm go. And she's got a slight tear. It's not good. So we'll find out how her arm is doing and then find out overall how she has able to handle the injuries in life that she has endured and how she's able to also endure the ups and the downs that WWE has brought her. But because of that, she is who she is today. And it's really, really inspiring to hear her story, including the sudden loss of her boyfriend that passed away. It's about a year and a half now at 26 years old. That is so sad. It all happened suddenly. So we're going to talk about that and so much more. There are things on here that she's revealing for the very, very first time. And I hope you guys will definitely listen to this all the way to the end, because let me tell you, there are some very big moments, especially towards the end of this interview, that you do not want to miss. So spread the word. Thanks again for following the show. And here we go. Without further ado, here is Dana Brooke's journey of chasing glory. The combination of beauty, brawn, and brains is an impressive mix to have, which happens to best describe WWE superstar Dana Brooke. Born in Cleveland, Ohio, she knew she had a future in athletics, but would obtain her degree in fashion, merchandising, and design while obtaining a minor in business administration from Kent State University, where she joined other notable alumni such as fellow WWE superstar Dolph Ziggler and Super Bowl champion Julian Edelman. After injuries derailed her gymnastics career, she would dedicate her life to health and fitness and pursue a future in bodybuilding, where she earned several championships in the National Physique Committee and would compete at the illustrious Arnold Classic. Dana would catch the eye of WWE scouts and would successfully try out and report to NXT under the guidance of some of the best veterans in pro wrestling. She would gain experience working the NXT loop and wrestling against rising stars at the time, Sasha Banks Bailey, Charlotte, and Alexa Bliss. Dana would make her main roster debut in the middle of the women's revolution, being an active competitor, and would also form an alliance with then women's champion Charlotte Flair. The combo would dominate the Raw women's division before Dana would begin to find her own identity and branch off on her own, making sure that she maintained a steady and strong figure during the historic revolution. She would make history by competing in the first ever Women's Royal Rumble and the inaugural WrestleMania Women's Battle Royal and the first ever all-women's WWE pay-per-view Evolution. Sky's the limit for this Ohio powerhouse who will always be ready for an opportunity thrown at her. It's about to get real, raw, and inspiring with Dana Brooke. Oh, I'm so happy about this because it is finally time to get Dana Brooke on Chasing Glory. Welcome. Welcome.
Thank you. I've been waiting for this moment. I'm honored to be on.
Oh, thank you. That's so sweet. I love it that I see you backstage and, you know, I've told you backstage, I'm like, hang tight. I want to get your story, but it's got to be at a good time, right? And you were like, oh my God, I'm ready.
Yeah, like 3 years. It's like, don't worry. I haven't forgot you. Then a year. Promise you, we're gonna find the right time. And I'm like, okay. And you've always told me timing is everything. No matter what it is, just for this show, whether it's work, whether it's just life in general. I mean, we've had some very personal, deep conversations, and you've always told me timing is everything.
It is. So it is. And I just felt like it was the right time. The fact that everything that I've been seeing you with Ronda Rousey, you know, setting up for the big WrestleMania match between her and Charlotte Flair and Becky Lynch, you've gotten thrown into the mix of that.
Not even expecting anything from it as well, too, because Road to WrestleMania, you know, it's very focused on what's going to be happening there. So as you know, my career has been highs, lows, ins, outs, you know, different variety of characters. I wasn't really expecting anything. And I feel as though like it was just perfect timing, like we have had mentioned too. So I was very blessed and fortunate that I was able to kind of really showcase truly how I feel and also be able to step up to the champ too. So it was definitely a great stepping stone for me.
Yeah. How did it feel for you when you got the news that you were going to be stepping into the ring with Ronda Rousey?
Oh my gosh. So Lil, like I've been off TV for so long and something, and I bet we'll get into this a little bit later, but I pitch constantly. I'm always giving ideas of things that I want to accomplish and do and how I want to, you know, springboard my character and launch my character. But truly, it's not a character anymore. This is really kind of like how I feel.
Yeah.
And so it really hurt my heart, honestly, because Fastlane was in Cleveland, Ohio. And I was on the road shows Friday, Saturday. And then Cleveland was my hometown. And we had Fastlane there. And I looked on my travel app and it was like Friday booked, Saturday booked, Sunday not booked. And I was like, you've got to be kidding me. For 3 months, I've been trying to just get on the show, whether it be the pre-show, whether it be on the, you know, panel, whether it be commentaries, just something backstage. And I wasn't booked. And I was like, wow, you know, like this is really hitting home. Like, I don't know how much more I can hang on, you know? And I just felt like defeated. And then Monday was in Pittsburgh. And I remember I was driving. I was like, okay, Ashley, go into work, put a smile on your face. You never know who has it worse. And that's how we'll get into it again. I don't like Mondays. There's a specific reason I just don't like Mondays. And I'm like, okay, I'm going into work. Positive day, positive thinking, blessed to be alive, blessed to have a job. And I go into work expecting nothing. You know, I'm like expecting absolutely nothing. I walk through the door and Dana Warrior, who's been one of my mentors for like going on 2 years now.
I love her.
Yeah, she's part of the writing team now, which is...
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I got to reach out to her. That's awesome. That's great. Yeah.
So I was so stoked. And Jen, who is also on the writing team, she's been like seriously a blessing to the women's division. Like she can grab these real raw emotions from us that I feel like haven't been reached before. So anyway, I walked through the door. Dana has this huge smile on her face. She's like, "Are you ready to kick some ass?" And I was like, "What?" She goes, "Yeah." She's like, "You have a big thing tonight. It's really going to make you shine." And I was like, "What?" Nothing else said. I keep walking a little further. Jen goes, "Hey, I'm going to get with you in a little bit. We have some great news for you." And I was like, "You've got to be kidding me. This is Road to WrestleMania. Like, what could possibly, what could this be?"
Right.
I'm thinking, like, honest to God, Will, I was thinking, like, backstage with, you know, EC3 again, or Elias. You know, I've just had these like little hints of like backstage things, and I'm grateful for it. You know, don't get me wrong. Any way that I can possibly be utilized, I'm like so happy for. So then all of a sudden, I go through makeup and Leslie's like, "Okay, you're on seg six. I was like, "What?" I'm like, "How do you know?" I was like, "What is it?" And she's like, "Oh, I'm not sure." She's like, "Why don't you go, you know, ask somebody?" And then Byron Saxton was walking through the hall and he's like, "Are you ready for your big night?" And I was like, "What?" And he goes, "You're calling out the champ." And I was like, "What?"
What?
I'm like, "This is no." I was like, "I think you got this wrong." And he's like, "No, I swear to God." And then I text Dana. I was like, did I hear this correctly? And she comes and she's like, "Yeah." And same thing, Jen and her got together with me and they had told me this. And I was like, I'll believe it when I see it. Like, I was like, I don't, you know, cause so then 3 weeks prior to that, I was supposed to have a match with Natty.
Yeah.
And we were seg 10. We got in the ring, we rehearsed and we had our match together, everything. And then I see the run sheet and I'm like, "What are you talking about? We're not on." And that just makes my heart, that like ripped my heart out of my chest. And then I think, is it personal reasons? Am I not good enough? Do they not believe in me? Like all this stuff. So I'm like, oh, I will never forget. I almost walked out of work that day when it was like, when I found out that me and Natty weren't having anything. I'm like, how am I the one always like that? Like it always happens where it's like, if I'm in a segment, it gets pulled, cut. I don't know. So when fast forward, when they had mentioned this to me, I'm like, okay, it's still early in the day. Who knows if this is even happening, you know?
Right.
And then, you know, with Rhonda, anything with Rhonda is like a really big deal. So I was just like, wow. Like it just did not settle with me yet. And it just took, I remember sitting out in the bowl and I looked up and it said WrestleMania. I was like, wow, this is really happening. Like I'm getting thrown into a story right before WrestleMania where it's like, you know, everybody is watching the show, seeing what's happening, like seeing what little twists and turns are happening.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, I can do this. You know, this is my time. I can really do this. And then at that point in time, I didn't know what it entailed or anything. I just knew I was calling out the champ and there was physicality. So again, I was still like, anything can change, anything can happen. So fast forward, we had a rehearsals and they were like, okay, you're going to, you know, cut your promo. And I was like, okay, I still don't know what I'm saying yet. And then they're like, okay, this is the physicality like on the back end. I'm like, okay, fine. You know, I was like, whatever I have to do, I will do, and I will make it look great. Like no matter what, you know?
Yeah.
And then, Jen had, you know, I talked to Jen every Thursday. We touched base on a phone call or something, running through ideas, like just throwing darts at whatever and hoping one like sticks.
Yeah.
She goes, "This is going to be you. This is going to be coming from your heart. This is going to be raw. This is going to be real." And she's like, "This is what I came up with, but put it in your own words. And I was like, okay. And I read it, and it's honestly how I've been feeling. Like,
wow.
First and foremost, you know, Rhonda was calling out the locker room. She's, you know, dissing the WWE. Take it for what it is. She's posted on YouTube cussing out, you know, WWE locker room, our talents, our, you know, just everyone.
Yeah.
And I took that really personal too, because it's like, I've been here for 5 years busting my tail just right. to get her, just for a second, like just to be heard, just to be, you know, felt like what true, like a true person feels like that gets told no, that's not handed anything, that's worked for this moment forever. So fast forward, I was getting ready for the promo, and Paul Heyman and I have a very close relationship as well. And Paul works very close with Rhonda as well. So I look at Paul and I said, Paul, I might cry. Like, I might truly cry. And he goes, that's okay. He's like, if you cry, that's okay. And I was like, I can't, I want to be brave. I want to stand up for all these women and children and females, males, everybody around the world. I want to be the voice for them, the voice for the locker room, the voice for the, like, this is it. So if I cry, I don't want to get caught up in the moment of cry. Like, I need to be brave. I need to stand my ground.
Yeah.
And so I just really tapped into a place in my heart where I felt like, from the moment I was a child until that second, everything that I've been through, everything that I've overcome, I was like, okay, this is my chance to go out there and be heard. And honestly, Lil, like this, I have nothing left to lose. Yeah. I really don't. Like, all I want is one chance. So I went out there, cut that promo. My voice cracked a couple times because
it was real.
Yeah, it was totally real. And I was like, fight back the tears, because I just want to come off as like, I mean business, I'm brave, I want to stand up for what I believe in. And then I thought, okay, beat down, great. Next week, I'm lucky if I'm even doing anything.
Yeah.
So I got through that promo. It went crazy all over the internet. I was so grateful for all the fans and the support that they had given me. And everything, like, I read all my messages, and I was like, that was Ashley, that was not Dana, you know. They like, and I went out with a look too, because Dana Warrior was like, let's just tone you down a little bit. And I was like, I'm all for it. I said, if I don't have to wear makeup, I don't want to wear makeup out there. Like, I feel like I need to portray who I really am. Like, yeah. I go to the gym every day. I am in no makeup. My hair's up in a ponytail. Like, look at me for who I am. Like, the raw, real Ashley. I don't want comments to be out there. Why did Dana wear her hair like that? Why is she looking like this? This and that. I don't care at this point anymore. I just want to be real and like relatable. So I went out there, did my thing, didn't think anything of it. Fast forward to last Thursday, I'm in the gym. And the text message, Jen, WWE comes up. I thought it was just to confirm our conversation for Thursdays, like we always have, to brainstorm ideas. And she's been amazing too, because I've messaged her a couple times where I'm like, I'm discouraged, Jen. I don't have any more ideas. So I thought for sure she would come back with a text message saying like, keep your head up high. She always is such a good motivator. And then she goes, Dana, so you have a championship women's title match on Monday. And I was like, I had to read it like 4 times. I'm like, you've got to be kidding me. This is, I like stopped the treadmill, and I called Ennis. I called my parents. I was like, I cannot believe this. Like, this is amazing. And there, and I, everyone was like super excited. I was super excited too. You know, I'm like stepping up against Ronda Rousey. Like, that is somebody in this entire, everyone in this world knows who she is. Like, it's not just because of WWE. It's because of her movies, her platform, her, you know, UFC, everything. I was like, it's just amazing. Out of anyone, I couldn't be more grateful for to like have my first title opportunity again.
Yeah.
So that was truly amazing. And, I was I was blessed to be on the live events with her and work with her as well on the weekend. And I couldn't ask for a better opponent because she truly brings out this realness in me. She brings out the determination, this willpower, this never give up attitude, me wanting to just be better. And what happened last Monday, I know was quick, but I can reassure you that everything that I did was for not only myself, but anyone that supports me, doubts me, loves WWE, loves the business that I'm in. I did it for all of us. Yeah, you know, it was definitely, I felt as though like, what am I doing? Like, why am I going out there? You know, what do I have to prove just to get dropped? And,
but no, it was intense though, Dana. It was intense. And even just that short bit that I saw, I was like, the two of you gelled very, very well together, first of all. But holy moly, I got to ask you, how's your arm? Because that was crazy.
I felt like it was going to get ripped off. If she like went any other way with it, I felt like it was just going to snap. In my head screaming like, get her off. Like, and I see the refs not touching her because yes, I know they're afraid of her, but I'm like, seriously, there's two of you in the freaking ring. There's one of me. Get her off.
Yeah.
You know, like yeah. I'm screaming for my life.
It's like she really took it to, she got into the moment for sure. Cause
exactly.
I hear that you hyperextended your left elbow and you've got a ligament tear. So
yeah,
hopefully.
That's right. I am trying my hardest to rehab this arm, to get back, you know, faster than ever. WrestleMania is coming back. This will not hold me down. It only motivates me more. Like,
yeah,
if anyone knows me, they know that, I've had injuries in the past from NXT. I was a gymnast for 18 years. I've lived with injuries my whole life, and nothing more motivates me than, you know, a little bit of a setback, because I can truly come back stronger than ever from this. And it goes to show, like, I don't want to say that an injury has to make this message, but what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. It truly does, because I've seen so many people in my life, in life in general, that have a problem in life or a setback, and then they just quit. But that's never the issue. It should only motivate you to become better. And a little setback makes you, you know, clear your mind, you know, see what clear path that you need to take. And honestly, I see my path, and I see that I can come back stronger than ever from this and really inspire thousands and millions of people out there in the world to just follow in my footsteps.
That's awesome. I do want to know, because you've said you've been at that point where when that match with you and Talia got nixed, that you wanted to walk out. What kept you? Because you just said don't quit, but you got to the point where you wanted to quit. So what made you not quit?
You know, something in life, you're always going to have obstacles put in your path. And I am a prime example from ever since I was a little girl to where I am now. You control your own destiny. And as much as WWE, they kind of guide you in the path of where you're going to be led to and, you know, where your path is going to go. And at that point in time, I feel like when I first started WWE NXT, it was like, go, go, go. And you control your own destiny and you control your own path. And then when I came up to the main roster, it was, you know, it was such a different transition and seeing people pass you before your eyes. And, you know, it takes a toll on your heart because you're like, what am I doing wrong? What can I do better? How can I be where they are? And you feel defeated so many times because it's like, it's like if you think of like a bench player or like a basketball game or baseball game or any child activity, you're on a bench full of people. And then the coach calls you in, right, to play. and you run like as fast as you can, like, okay, yeah, I get to play. And you get one play and then they're like, okay, go sit back on the baseline. And that's truly like how I've been feeling. And I'm like, I don't know what more I can possibly do at this point. Like, this is not me. WWE doesn't define who Ashley is. Like, I'm a strong competitor inside the ring, outside the ring, in the journey through life. Like, so when I had been told that, like, okay, your match isn't happening, I, at that point in time, I was just like, no, this place does not define me. I'm stronger than this. I want to go and prove to the world that, you know, you can't keep me down. And I literally went to Jen and I was like, I can't believe this. I truly need to better myself and this and that. And, then I went in the locker room, I put my head down and I thought through everything that I have been through. I've been through injuries. I've been through deaths in my life. I've been through personal experiences growing up in my childhood. And I said, you know something, if I quit now, what kind of example am I going to be for everyone that's followed me, who's supported me, who's been my backbone through the hardest times? I said, I cannot give up now. Like, I can't. I can only pick myself up, put my head up, put a smile on my face, because there are millions of people in this world that would die to walk a mile in your shoes.
I love that you realize that, because I know that there's so many people out there that, you know, they have the 9-to-5 job or something and they look at the WWE superstars and they go, what are you complaining about? Right. And there are things that people don't know until they walk in your shoes and in the shoes that I've been through, even, you know, as an announcer and all. It's easier said than done with the road schedule and then what you guys put your bodies through. But I love that you do accept the fact that it can always be worse. It can always be worse. Yeah.
Truly, you know, it's just, you look at people, you know, for example, I was in the gym last week training and I remember I was on shoulder press and I'm tired, Lil. And you know, you're on the road and you're tired, but you know, you have to get in the gym and get it done. And some days you're like, what am I doing? Why am I even here? I should just, you know, give it up. And I look in front of me and it was like God, or, you know, I don't know what people believe, but like somebody put this man in front of me. He had no legs and one arm.
Oh, wow.
Two prosthetic legs and one prosthetic arm.
Yeah.
And he's doing it. You know, what struggle every day do people wake up and deal with? Depression, being suicidal, having an illness, waking up with aches and pains. And I'm complaining.
Right.
Why am I complaining? I'm healthy. I have the best job in the entire world. No matter how hard it is, people are knocking to be where I am, like knocking on WWE's door. They are busting their butts to be where I am. And why am I complaining?
Yeah.
So it's just kind of, you have to put your head down and really kind of think about it and know that somewhere out in this world, someone has it worse. And if I could inspire just one person, just one, to never give up on their dreams, then my job is accomplished.
That's awesome. So I want to get to know you, Ashley, better. I want to get to know the Ashley, not the Dana. I do love the whole idea of you toning it down and being more you. I think that absolutely is going to work because I think
you
are enough.
Thank you.
And have you felt like you're enough?
There's been times where I have felt, you know, people look, perception is reality too. So they see an outer shell and then they just kind of judge you upon that. And I was in the fitness and bodybuilding career for such a long time. And they look at you at your aesthetics and how you look. And, you know, it's like, that's hard because they only look at you from your outside and they don't look at you for your inside. And that's one thing too, that I've truly tried to overcome, and it's so hard. You know, I've been through weight fluctuations in my career at WWE, and at the end of the day, you have to look in the mirror and look at your two eyes and look in those eyes and look deep down inside into your heart and into your soul to truly find who you really are.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter, you know, like somebody's going to love you for who you are, not what you look like. And that's something that I feel as though WWE allows everyone to showcase. We have different, you know, colors. We have different shapes, sizes, male, females, you know, and when I mean sizes, we have, you know, giants to midgets. We have, you know,
right,
skinny to bigger, you know, people.
Right.
So they do not discriminate. And that's truly something so special that I hope everybody can realize, that WWE is a place of acceptance.
Yeah.
Not, they don't, they're not judgmental.
Yeah.
The only people that are hard are, we are hard on ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. So yeah, you know, I do feel as though that I'm accepted there, but am I always feeling like I can be better? Of course, but that's what kind of keeps me going.
I agree. But I also think that you've put yourself in a career where you've been judged a lot.
Your
competitions after competition after competition, you're constantly waiting for someone to judge you, to tell you whether you're good enough or not. You know, whether it's the Arnold Classic that you've gone in, you know, in the places that you've actually, the place that you've placed, you know, whether it's 12th place or 14th place or say, you know, in the competition. So it's easy for you to actually get to a point where you're like, wow, why am I not number one? What's going on? And so you start definitely questioning yourself. And I know, because it's the same kind of like when I used to do pageants, it's the same thing, as you get judged, you get judged. And I used to do some fitness stuff too. And so all of a sudden it was like, well, wait, why didn't I place, you know?
Yeah.
So you start questioning yourself, and that's when the doubts start going, am I good enough? Am I good enough? But let's, so let's really dive into Ashley. So you were born in Cleveland, Ohio. Tell me what it was like for you growing up.
I was born in Cleveland, Ohio, and I have such an amazing, strong family. My mom's name is Robin. My dad's name is Bruce. And I have a younger sister who's 26 years old now, currently. And her name is, or 27. Oh my gosh. She just turned 27.
That's cool.
Where time goes, I have no idea. She's still always going to be my baby sister. Her name is Brittany. And she's teaches special needs children in high school. Yeah. So she has a heart of gold as well. Family's been my life. Family will always be my life. My dad has, he's a part of six brothers and sisters, and my mom has one sister. And we've always been such a close-knit family. And my dad worked all of his life just to provide for his girls. Like, that was it. Like, he is such a family man, and he wants his girls to be happy and survive. Mm-hmm. And, but to the point where we grew up in a very strict household where it was like school, education, sports, everything was just, you know, number one. And my mom was, she loved to work. She worked. But then my dad said, no, I want you to be home with your girls. And I want them to feel like they can count on us being parents for whatever they possibly need. So I was very, very fortunate. And I was a gymnast for 18 years. And again, I started super young, like the age of 2 or 3 years old. And I had a connection to my mom, Lil. And I still have this connection. My mom is my best friend, and I could never leave my mom's side, like ever. And to this day, she's my best friend. And I remember, like, I don't remember, but this was what was told of me, is I was in parent taught, you know, gymnastics classes, and my mom would be at my side. And then growing up throughout gymnastics, my mom would always have to be at the practice, and I would have to have her in my sight. And we have this bond that nobody can ever break. And my parents have instilled such love in my heart that, like, I love each and every person equally in my entire like life. But yeah. when I love one person, I love hard, just like I was grown up in. And so at that point in time, gymnastics was my only true love, like my passion, my life, everything. And I was very fortunate enough that, you know, my mom was able to adjust my school schedule. And all I knew was gymnastics. I would wake up and, you know, super early, go into the gymnastics facility, do strength and conditioning, then go straight to school, start school, have my school schedule adjusted to be pulled out of school early so my mom could take me to the practice facility. I would train for 4 to 5 hours a day, get home at 9 o'clock at night, do my homework, be in bed around 10 or 11 o'clock and do it all over again, all over again. And I was, all I knew was dedication. All I knew was, determination. Like that was truly it. If I fell down, I had to get right back up. And gymnastics is an individual sport, you know, and it wasn't, it was all about me. It was all about what I accomplished. It was all about, who I wanted to become, what I wanted to achieve. So I was very hard on myself as well too in gymnastics. So was my coaches. I landed in, the Junior Olympics, when I was 13 or 12 years old. And my dream was to be in the Olympics. My dream was to land a spot in the U.S. Olympic team.
Oh, wow.
And, at the Junior Olympics, it was in Norfolk, Virginia. I was doing gymnastics on the bars and I flipped off and I cracked my nose and my neck like snapped back and they thought I was paralyzed.
Oh, and wow.
I laid there and it was like in a bowl. So everyone was like looking down and I couldn't move. And my coaches came around me and I was like, I blacked out. And I remember waking up and I look up and everyone is looking over me saying like, you can't move, don't move, don't move. And all I remember is my mom coming and looking over me and she started crying. And I said, I'm okay. Like I was okay, but they would not let me move. Like they thought my neck and I was paralyzed and everything like that. And that was truly my first injury. And at that point in time, I was just like, I don't know how I'm going to be able to overcome this fear. I never had fear in my life. And then I started to remember the road to recovery was like, granted, the only thing I suffered was a broken nose and like my jaw was fractured. And I wasn't paralyzed, thank God.
Right.
But I just had a, you know, fear in my heart. Like, how can I do this move again? How can I, you know, do this and that? And I overcame that fear just by pushing through. And I give it to my parents too, because they said, you know, keep living your dream, Ashley Mae. If this is what you want to do, keep doing it. We'll support you, but know that, you know, don't stop. Just try it again. Give it a go. Wow.
It's that whole thing where they talk about if you fall off the horse, get back up on it
and
again.
Keep riding. Yeah.
That's awesome that they did that. Yeah.
So I went back, I put my nose to the grinds, kept going. I went to regionals, I went to nationals, and then I was on the international team traveling with the U.S. And all of a sudden, I was in a gymnastics meet for qualifying for, I think it was another international meet. And I was running down the vault and I landed short. And I was like, oh my God, my ankle. I was like, you've got to be kidding me. I'm like, and I start hobbling off. And, then they were like, can you keep doing this? I was like, yeah, I can keep going. Probably the worst idea ever, because that day I ended up going to the hospital, getting it checked. I had broken bones, torn ligaments, and then I had reconstructive ankle surgery. And then again, I was just like, this is the worst feeling ever. What a setback. My dreams, everything were like, wow, where do I go now? And bad example, I should never have done this, but I cut my cast off.
Oh boy.
I was like, I'm going back. Like I cannot be, you know, this is not holding me back. From that point forward, I could not get back on my horse and start riding again. It was just, that was the end of the path, the journey. I couldn't get back to where I was. I didn't let my ankle fully heal and recover. And all of my dreams at that point in time, like, went down the toilet. And I'll never forget. I felt lost. I felt so like, what did I just work 18 years of my life for?
Yeah.
I wanted to go to college. I didn't even think, when people thought, what do you want to do when you get older? It was to be on the Olympics gymnastics team. What do you, they were like, okay, but what do you want to go to school for? And I was like, I don't know. You know, I was just gymnastics. And I was in high school at the time too. And they were like, okay, well, why don't you try diving? And I was like, I don't want to. But then I was like, okay, fine. I need to be active, get my mind off of things. And so it was like, I went into diving and I like ran off the diving board, did a couple flips into the water. And like, I mean, us girls, I hated diving because I didn't want to get my hair wet. I didn't want to go swimming. Like, I was like, okay, what am I doing this for? And I was district champ within my first year. And then I was state champ. And then I went into regionals.
Wow. And so you did so good, but you didn't like it.
I couldn't stand it. It was like one event, running off the board, jumping into the water. I'm like, you know, it was just, it wasn't my passion. It wasn't a dream of mine. And my parents, again, supporting me, were like, if you don't like it, it's okay. You know, we're not making you do it. My cheerleaders behind me were like, my parents, don't worry about it. Mm-hmm. So I was like, I don't want to do this anymore. Like, I don't want to do this.
Chasing Glory with Lilian Garcia.
Pardon this interruption, but I have a very, very important message to tell you, and that's because I'm about to talk about food. Who doesn't love food? Well, you're going to love Green Chef. Why are you going to love Green Chef? Because they're a USDA certified organic company. Remember, I tell you that eating organic is very, very important. And this is a meal kit that comes straight to your door. So Green Chef has all these different recipes. And what I love about them is that whatever it is that the recipe calls for, that's what comes in your little brown bag. That's right. So if the recipe calls for 2 carrots, you're going to get 2 carrots. So that way you're not going to waste anything. So let me tell you how this works. Basically, you log on, you have your choice of paleo, vegan, vegetarian, pescatarian, Mediterranean, heart smart, lean and clean, keto, gluten-free, and omnivore. There you go. You've got it all covered. Whatever it is that you want to eat, however it is that you like to eat as far as healthy-wise, then you've got a choice with them, and they will pack it up and send you the food along with the recipe cards, and it is just so much fun to cook because it's easy to follow step by step with pictures, the instructions. Everything is handpicked and delivered right to your door. And ingredients come pre-measured, like I said, perfectly proportioned, and mostly also prepped. So it is that easy. Recently, I actually cooked one that's called the chicken with apricot pan sauce. Let me just tell you the ingredients. That way your mouth can just water. It was chicken breast, rosemary balsamic marinade, red beets, spiced sesame seeds, carrots, red onion, dried apricots, and parsley. And it was spectacular. And because they contain a variety of organic ingredients, like I said, it's good for you. So check them out for yourself. Don't just listen to what I have to say. For all my listeners, all you have to do is go to greenchef.us/chasingglory. All right, so what is that going to get you? That's going to get you $50 off your first box of Green Chef. You got to eat, so try it out. greenchef.us/chasingglory.
Chasing Glory. $50 savings. Check it out. You know what? As a matter of fact, go ahead, take a picture of it, tweet it to me, send it to me, and let me see it, or even on Instagram. Make sure you post me, and that way I can repost you. All right? So greenchef.us, Chasing Glory, for $50 off. Okay, now back to the show.
Hi, this is Nita Strauss, and you're listening to Chasing Glory with Lilian Garcia.
Before you continue, I think it's a good lesson because a lot of people, as we've talked about before too, about don't quit something.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's not bringing you joy,
no,
and it's not bringing you peace, that's not quitting. That's
right.
Choosing a different path that brings you joy and peace. You've got one life to live.
Amen. So you said it.
It needs to be something that you're very, very, like, the word is, passionate about. Otherwise, what's it all for?
Exactly. 100%. 100%. So I was like, okay. So I stopped diving. And again, I had no vision. I had no clue. And they were like, you know, where are you going to go to school? And in my head, I was like, well, I have no idea, because I thought I was going to get scholarships for gymnastics. I thought I was going to land somewhere, compete, go through gymnastics, land on the Olympic team. You know, the Olympic trials were coming up because it was every 4 years. So I did the Junior Olympics, and then fast forward, the Olympic trials were coming up. And I remember those Olympic trials came. I was so depressed, like watching these girls that I used to train with go out for it. And again, what I am going through in WWE, it takes me back to what I felt like when I was on the sidelines, just watching time go. And, I was like, okay, what colleges are nearby? And then I saw Kent State University, and I was like, okay, what's Kent good for? You know, they have amazing school programs. And I was like, what could I see myself in? And they had a great fashion program. And I love fashion. I love clothing, the latest trends, everything. And I was like, okay, fine. But I was not passionate about it. Mm-hmm. Like, and my parents always told me, go to school, get a degree, everything like that. So I, you know, plugged along, and I went to school 4 years and went for fashion, merchandising design, business, and minor in marketing. And throughout that school, it was just, you know, 4 years in college, people go out, you live your life, you start really kind of honing in on what you're going to school for and finding your close-knit friends and, you know, going out and experiencing life, whether it be a party, sorority club, you know, just anything.
Yeah.
I was missing something, Will. And I was just like, what am I doing? I started putting on weight and not feeling comfortable in my own skin and in a bad relationship. Because growing up, I wasn't involved in any boys' school dances. I was left out of everything because I was on a narrow track, like just gymnastics. So, you know, college, like I said, I started dating somebody, and it was a very toxic, bad relationship. But I told you, once I love hard. So right. I wasn't giving up on that person. And all of a sudden I was like, man, this is a bad path that I have to pull out of it. I was not happy in my own skin, and I just needed to be active again. I was out of the gym, everything. I was like, let me go back to my roots. And my girlfriend called me. Her name is Sarah. And she called me and she's like, hey, Ash, did you ever think about, you know, bikini fitness competitions and all that? I was like, you know, Sarah, no, I'm not doing that. I went and I modeled, and throughout, you know, college, I was like, I modeled. I did Miss Hawaiian Tropic. Like, I was like, no, I'm good on that. She's like, no. This is like, you, she's like, you get in the gym, you follow a strict diet, you know, lift weights, you get your body back in shape, you have a goal, and your goal is, you know, you step on stage and you show this amazing physique that you've trained for and all this. And I was like, okay, I said, I'll give it a try. I said, so this is like a weight loss program. I was so naive at the point. She's She's like, yeah, this is it. I was like, okay. And so I followed it, that program and that diet, like to a T. And I'm like, this is amazing. I step on stage. I was in bikini first. And I did a couple bikini competitions and I placed first, went to, cause you start in the amateurs and the same thing. You start on a very amateur league. Then you get qualified for nationals. And then when you're qualified for nationals, if you place well, then you earn your pro card. And then I got to the national stage in bikini and I was like, wow, this is so political. I said, this is like pick of the litter. Like if at this competition, if you're sponsored by the main sponsor of the show, maybe you'll place well, or if they want a blonde this time, they'll pick a blonde. If they want a brunette, they'll pick a brunette. It's not based on talent. It's not based on, you look great and everything like that, but you know, it's bare, like you just, there's a lot of things behind it. And I saw the fitness competition, which it goes bikini, figure, fitness, and bodybuilding. Mm-hmm. And fitness is right up my alley. It was a 2-minute like fitness gymnastics routine. So like it was amazing. And then it was based on your body and your physical, you know, fitness.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, let me give this a try. I loved it. It brought everything back into my life. Like everything. And it brought back the gymnastics, the performing. So anyway, fast forward to that. I landed that, traveled the world, got my pro card within the first year. And, I started competing there and it just brought it was like a full circle. Like it was something that I was passionate about. I fell in love with, and then it springboarded me into landing this amazing WWE career.
And how did that happen? How did you get into the WWE?
So I was competing in, fitness and I was traveling all around. So as I mentioned, family is my life. And my dad has, he was part of 6 brothers and sisters. So growing up, my dad, myself, and my uncle, we would always watch wrestling, like WWE. And every Sunday morning, was like my mornings off if I wasn't in gymnastics. And this is when I was like a little girl.
Yeah.
And my dad and my uncle always watched wrestling. And my mom would be like, what are you watching? Like, I don't want my daughter to watch this stuff. I was like a balls to the wall child to bouncing all around, you know, I was fearless. And so then every Sunday morning, me and my dad would end up wrestling, playing with stuffed animals, and I would wrestle my stuffed animals and my uncle would be my manager and we would have like all of this stuff. So then fast forward, we were in the car. My aunt had passed away from cancer. And, we were in the car and we were like, hey, do you remember when we used to like, we were just, you know, thinking of old memories and stuff like that. And I was like, wow. Yeah. I was like, this was such an amazing, amazing time in my life growing up where we would all just watch wrestling and play wrestle and stuff like that. I was like, yeah, we were all so happy. And, so then that was just a little moment that, you know, happened. And then I was competing in Arnold, Spain. And then somebody came up to me and said, hey, are you interested in wrestling? And I was like, what are you talking about? I'm like, amateur wrestling? Absolutely not. Sorry. Like, no.
Yeah.
And they're like, have you ever heard of WWE? And I was like, yeah,
of course.
Yeah, of course. And they're like, yeah, you know that. And I was like, oh my God. I was like, are you kidding me? And they're like, we love your personality. Your personality is so perfect for this. You're athletic. You know, you're strong. It's right up your alley.
Who was that? Somebody from the office?
Yes, it was. So Canyon Seaman.
Yeah.
And then, it was actually with my fitness coach, Mike Davies.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were all competing and talking. And Lexi Kaufman was actually one of Mike Davies' clients as well.
Oh, wow.
Got into wrestling before me. And he's like, okay, you know, Lexi Kaufman's doing it and this and that. And I was like, oh, okay, I'll give it a shot.
And for those people that don't know, Lexi is Alexa Bliss.
Yeah. Yes. And so then I remember I was like, okay, this is a huge leap for me. If I leave fitness, which I was on the tip top of my game, to go into something that I'm not too sure about, if I can't, you know, pick up or anything like that, I'm leaving such a comfort zone, right?
Yeah.
But I never wanted what ifs in life, like ever, never what ifs in life. And I thought to myself, if this can make my family close again, if this can make, because we weren't distant, but something that I've never really shared with people is my dad's other sister, her name is Kathy. She's a recovering alcoholic, but it was bad. Like I grew up and I saw her relapse so many times to the point where she would find in the house Listerine and drink Listerine and eat toothpaste just to like get the alcohol out of it.
Did she live with you guys?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
And I've used to find her on numerous occasions and I would have to pick her up and get her strong again. And
how old were you?
She started when I was 13 years old and we found her on the news. And, it's a very like deep, deep personal conversation, but I'm willing to share it with you guys because I hope it inspires people also too, because I would find her where people, my family would start to give up on her. Cause it was like, she was starting to lie, sneak. She would hide alcohol bottles in the vents of our house.
Yeah.
She, would get kicked out of my parents' house because it was ruining our upbringing.
Yeah.
Because I would see my parents get into, you know, confrontation. Like, I don't want this to be at our house where our kids are being raised. And then, you know, so then my family made the decision to, you know, kick her out, move her with my grandmother who was very sick at the time. My grandma was in the hospital. My dad's brothers and sisters were like, we're finished. You know, she has not helped herself. She never wanted to help herself. And, so when there'd be numerous times where she had a younger son, who's my cousin, and couldn't find his mom, couldn't talk to his mom. And
oh my God.
Yeah, I would be the one to never give up on my aunt. And I would find her so many times laying in bed, not with it. I found her, she went missing. There was a missing like report on her in Ohio. And I didn't give up until I found her in jail and nobody else knew where she was. And I wasn't 18 at the time. So I had to call my dad and beg and plead him to come and get her out. And, I never gave up on her and she, still is dealing with this condition. And later on in my journey through WWE, I'll tell you another reason why I've never given up. And, so she was a huge part of me kind of doing WWE again and like taking this tryout because I felt as though our family, my aunts, my uncles, everybody could have like a common ground to talk about what we used to, you know, joke and do everything again.
Lighter times because so, things got heavy.
Yeah. Very.
Yeah. How very what heavy. Do you? What does that do to you at 13 watching this and it being in your household and being for so long constant?
It truly makes me see that something so powerful can take over you, not just alcohol, but anything in life, whether it be a relationship, whether it be drugs, whether it be something gamble. I don't know. People have their stories in life that they're fine in life and something alters them off track. And you personally are the only one that can get yourself back up and on the right track. And alcoholism is a disease, but you know, you can overcome it. And she's had long, long strides of sobriety where it's, whether it be 6 months, and she was sober, I think for the longest time, 3 years, and then something triggers her to go right back off track.
Wow.
So it shows that, you know, no matter what, through hard times, again, my message that I preach so much is you can always pick yourself up and keep moving forward and never give up on yourself.
Yeah.
So, you know, my family, again, my parents, everybody supported me. I moved to Orlando. I started training and I fell in love with it. In love with it. Like when I tell you that this was like, where was this all my life? It's so amazing to the point where it's not only what I'm doing, but it's also like the organization, the business. It's such a family.
Yeah.
What WWE has to offer, like as far as like the charity events, you know, what WWE is connected with. I was like, wow, this is the platform I need, you know, but this makes me feel happy. This makes me feel at home. Everybody around me is like, you know, to make light of this situation, we have to be some kind, like any person within WWE has to have a little bit of craziness on them because it's like, why are we doing this? So it felt like at home, you know,
because
we all have the same drive. And obviously coming off of something in my family that is so addictive, I guess maybe I have an addictive personality as well. And wrestling is my addiction. Like I have come down to where it's like, I want more and I want more and I want more. And how can I be better? And what can I do? And like,
so that makes sense. When you're not getting your dose of being out there, having your matches, performing, it totally makes sense why it is really hurting you too inside. And you're guessing, and can I really do this? And should I do this? Because if you're that's your addiction and you're not getting your dose of it, then it's like, you're drying up.
Yeah. And I'm like, what can I do? You know, like, where's my fix?
Right.
And that's my outlet, you know, that's my outlet to feel like have this passion come outside of me and perform and see thousands of people cheering, and it brings families together, you know, like relationships together, people that share common interests, kids, and like, it's a family event. And that kind of goes back to what I'm talking about, where it brought my family together and it brings such a close bond. And seeing these children, again, how I've said, we never know who has it worse out in the world. And seeing kids that, you know, are in wheelchairs, or when I'm backstage and there's Make-A-Wish children that have cancer, to see that they look at us and forget all their problems, it makes it so worth it.
Plus,
so
you've been on stage since you were 2 years old. You just said it. You've been in gymnastics since you were two. Like, this this is home for you, to be in front of a crowd, to be performing. That's what's natural for you.
Exactly.
You talked about the fact that you had to endure even going through a death. Mm-hmm. Like, just, it's going to be 2 years in August that you lost your ex-boyfriend.
Yes.
And his name is Dallas McCarver.
Correct.
And he was a bodybuilder.
Mm-hmm.
Now there were, when this happened, I remember it all came out, and I remember I immediately reached out to you, and I couldn't believe it. I was shocked, just as I'm sure you are.
Mm-hmm.
Is this anything to do with why you say you hate Mondays?
Yeah. Totally, Lil. And I'll never forget, just recap of it, fast forward. Dallas, so in wrestling, I loved it. I loved performing. But as people can relate, it's very hard to find somebody that is so supportive outside of the business, because you're not home. And because your life is so dedicated on being the best you possibly can, being strong, and you need somebody to share common interests. And Dallas totally did. He understood my schedule, my travel. We shared something so in common, which when I left wrestling. And I came home to being so dedicated in the gym, somebody that shared the same passion that I had before. And we always wanted to be better for one another, like how we, and that's why we became so strong. Mm-hmm. And so first and foremost, he supported, you know, everything. And then fast forward, we were in SummerSlam in Barclays Center. Mm-hmm. And I left Boca. I was living in Boca at the time. And it was very, it's just weird to me, like, how it all happened, because I wasn't going to ever come home or see or anything like that again. And that Monday, as I was telling you, I don't like Mondays. I left work, was so excited to fly home. And that Monday, actually, I was backstage and the last person I had spoke with, it's just so weird how this all works. It was Dana Warrior. Mm. And, you know, she lost her husband as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, I would always check up on her, like, Dana, how are you? This and that. And she's like, you know, I'm great. And we would always share like such a strong bond.
Yeah.
And we had called Dallas that night, and we had spoke on FaceTime, everything like that. And that was the last conversation, was us three. It was Dallas, Dana, and myself. And then fast forward, I was driving to my hotel with Tennille, Emma. Mm-hmm. We would always room together. And all of a sudden I got a phone call saying, like, call 911, all this stuff. We can't get Dallas up. And they were trying to tell me, like, he can still be saved, but I knew something. I just knew it. And I then, I was just like, he's gone, you know, he's gone. And it's such a blur to me at this time, because I haven't gone there in such a long time. Like, yeah. I haven't relived it. So it's very hard. If I'm like kind of off, you know, not really making a lot of sense, because it's such a dark time. But I've learned to, like, push it away, as I had mentioned with Ennis,
yeah,
who I'm currently with now, who's helped me a lot through this, as I had mentioned. So he's been a blessing for me. But so
you're talking about your current boyfriend. He's an NBA basketball player, Ennis Cantor.
Right. Ennis Cantor. Yeah. Yeah. So who I'm currently with. Yes. And so at that point in time, it was just such a dark place. I remember Monday night, I knew it. I wasn't coming home to him. And, I got off the plane and my mom met me, and I walked in and I sat down, and there was, like, his blood still. And I couldn't really, like, I was just like, what happened? You know, I couldn't even, like, focus on anything else. And, like, thousands of messages came through, and there was rumors that he had choked and all this thing, and things got twisted and everything got just so crazy. And Mark Carano called, and WWE was so amazing as far as, like, take as much time as you need. We're here for you. And I kept my circle very small, as I still do. My circle's very small. And I just felt so alone. And my mother was there, and I just didn't know even where to pick up after. Like, I just didn't know how to move on or carry forward or what I possibly had to live for. I had wrestling, which that was my passion and my love. But then the other thing that why I'm wrestling is to also provide for my family and my future and everything like that. And so I just felt lost. And so I was in a dark, dark place for a very long time. And it came, so that happened Tuesday. And then Corano was like, take as much time as you needed. And I remember I could not eat. I could not sleep. Mm-hmm. And the only thing I wanted, Lilian, was to go and wrestle again. And because that was my outlet, that's where I forgot everything.
Yeah.
And it fast forwards to, he was born in Memphis, Tennessee, or he lived in, you know, was raised in Memphis, Tennessee. And that Monday night was that next Monday night was in Memphis, Tennessee.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So we did all of his funeral arrangements and everything like that over. It was just, it's just so crazy how the pattern
right
of events, and it even gets more crazy. So we did his funeral, we did his wake, and it felt like my hands were like, okay, what would Dallas want me to do? And that would be wrestle, continue to be the best I could be, push through, do everything. So I was like, okay, that's it. Mm-hmm. So I didn't take any time off of work. I went to work. I focused. I did my thing, kept putting my nose to the grind, pushing through, pushing through, pushing through. But wrestling was only Friday through, you know, Tuesday. And so when I would come home, I moved immediately out of the house that we had lived in.
Yeah.
And I was alone, you know, and I was so alone, and I was so close to Dallas's mom and my mom and stuff like that. And I just felt so lost and so like, just what am I doing? I stayed out of the gym for so long just because
really?
I just didn't have any passion.
Yeah.
And then again, it was like, I just was not myself, feeling like, what am I living for? What's happening? Just very dark in my life. And I told my Dallas's mom, was like, you know something, Ashley, don't live your life like this. Don't live your life, you know, sheltered and alone and stuff. She's like, you will find love again. And I was like, no, I won't. And she's like, no, truly, Ashley Mae, like, you will be able to let yourself go, be friends with someone, you know, just let your heart feel, you know, it might be years from now, it might be, you know. So anyway, fast forward like 8 or 9 months, and I was wrestling my first time at MSG. And all of a sudden I see this person walk by, and I knew from the moment, like, there was something special about him. And it was Ennis. Mm-hmm. And I, like, he loved, like, so anyway, how I got to know Ennis was, he loves wrestling. Loves wrestling. And he actually, after his NBA career, wants to become a WWE superstar.
Seriously? And,
yeah.
That's awesome.
That's like his dream.
Wow.
And so at first it was like, we just said hi, whatever. And I was wrestling Asuka that night. And he was like, you know, hi. And we got a photo together because he played for the New York Knicks. So mm-hmm. it was at MSG where they play.
Yeah.
Through passing, just go, right? And then social media these days are so, thank God, you know. So then we started following one another. And his religion and his culture is so strong. And he is so funny because he's Muslim, so he wasn't allowed to like look at women in a certain way, and, you know, wrestling and stuff like that. He wasn't allowed to watch the women perform and wrestle.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, fast forward. We started messaging a little bit here and there. And I was like, did you watch my match? He's like, no, I can't. Like, I couldn't. I was like, why? And he's like, because I couldn't watch you know, women that are not like fully clothed and stuff.
Yeah.
I was like, oh my God, I respect that, you know? And then we started getting to talk, and then it was so weird because he could sense something, you know, he could sense some kind of pain or something that I hadn't been able to like let go.
Mm-hmm.
And I never really opened up to anyone ever about this. And I opened up to him and I let it all out, because I felt as though if I met somebody, I tried to talk to another man or person in my life, I would feel judged, or they would say like, why are you crying about this person? You know, am I not good? You know, they would feel like he's somebody that I still love or am in love with.
Right.
Ennis let me cry. Ennis held my hand. Ennis would talk to me on the phone and he got me through some of the hardest times where I felt like in wrestling, I would go to work on a Monday, not be used. I would call him crying, like, why am I wrestling anymore? I don't even know why I'm doing this, you know? And he would just be like, Ashley, push through, girl. Like, you're doing this because you're inspiring thousands. He prays for Dallas still, like, you know, do this for him. You know, keep pushing through. It's like put this like walking, living angel in front of me. And he is like, holds my hand and he motivates me. And, he's at the darkest times where I wanted to walk away from everything and wrestling. And this, he wouldn't, he just did not. Here's the kicker. So SummerSlam of this past year, Ennis told me, because he had known that it would have marked 1 year for Dallas passing.
Yeah.
It was in the same venue.
Oh, my God.
The same place. The same date.
That's crazy.
And Ennis would not leave my side. And I'm very superstitious, right? I flew my mom in. And I said, Mom, is anything going to happen? She's like, no, Ashley May. I said, anyone going to die? And she goes, no. And like, I just need reassurance, you know?
Yeah.
And I was at sushi with Ennis that night. And I was like, wow, SummerSlam, it's great. Okay, we got through this 1 year. Thank you so much. You know, he's like, I told you I'll never leave your side, Ashley, through everything. Like, I was with Titus Worldwide at the time. I just had like a little promo skit.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, the huge weight was lifted off my shoulder. I got through that day, which I thought was going to be the hardest day. So we go through, get sushi. I'm supposed to fly back to Florida. My mom's in the hotel room waiting for me to come back. I get back through those doors and she has a smile on her face, but I could tell something's wrong. And again, it's August 22nd, 1 year after Dallas passed. She goes, let's call your father. I said, why? We called my dad, and my dad said, Aunt Kathy is in critical condition. My aunt, who's an alcoholic.
Oh my God.
And I said, why? What happened? He said she had fallen down the steps and cracked her neck, and they found her 2 hours after the incident.
Oh my God.
And they don't know if she's going to make it. I said, you've got to be kidding me. And so needless to say, they got through, they put her in surgery, found alcohol in her system. And to this day, she's in the hospital and she's paralyzed.
To this day?
Yeah.
Oh my God. I'm so sorry. I didn't know that.
Yeah. I haven't shared it a lot, but I thought since you're getting very, like, we're getting very deep and personal as far as why I never gave up on her and what pushed me through fitness and bodybuilding and my family being so close and just like the trace of events
yeah.
that happened. So again, Ennis to my rescue comes and sits down with me and tells me, like, okay, let's keep pushing through, Ash. Like, let's keep going. I was like, what is happening? And I never really even imagined, like, being able to, like, be able to pick up and go after 1 year Dallas and my aunt, who nobody even knows about my aunt. But, yeah. Like, you know, when you're on social media, you present this persona of always happy and always, right. You know, this yep. beautiful life and training and being blessed with everything. But deep down inside, behind closed doors, you never really know what's going on in someone's life.
Yeah.
And so I would go home, and I go home very often, and I go and see my aunt. And my aunt always tells me, Ashley, do this for me. Do this for me, and one day I will be able to walk again. Oh. And Mondays, she always watches me. Always watches me, no matter good. If I'm on or off. She watches me, and she's in the hospital on her. She's the proudest aunt, Lil. When I go and I see her, she has all the nurses coming. She's like, this is my my niece. And, yeah. you know, she's always supporting me. And my new motivation since August is to help her walk again and never give up. Like, I will never give up. And, And so it kind of all, like, it has its ups and its downs and its ins and its outs, but through everything, it always, you just never have to give up. And I just always want to inspire that to thousands of people, no matter what life throws at you, who comes in and out of your life, just always keep pushing on, yeah. keep pushing forward and living your dreams. And, you know, always know that some people in this world have it worse.
Yeah. Wow. Dana, I had no idea you were going to end up with that. And I really want to thank you for opening up. Really.
Thank you.
Because your story definitely has been very, very inspiring. And without all those little details, it wouldn't add up to what now yeah. totally makes sense.
And that's why, everything. You know, it's like, you never feel like, I just want to put it all out there, and you never know what tomorrow brings. Right. So like when 2 weeks ago I cut that promo where it's like, all I want is a chance.
Yeah.
All I want is a chance to go out there and make these little girls' dreams come reality, where it's like they've been told no, 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 no for so long that they can't do something, or they try and get injured, or something happens so tragic in their life that they just want to give up.
Yeah.
Male, female, no matter what. Pick up and keep pushing through, you know,
yeah.
and if a death occurs or something so tragic in your life happens, find somebody that is going to stand next to you no matter what and hold your hand. And I'm blessed that WWE has never given up on me. I know I've been through ups and downs with the company, leaps and bounds, but I will never give up on them. And I'm so glad they haven't given up on me. And, it's truly so amazing to be able to tell my story, and like yeah. you've been able to bring out a side of me and vulnerability, but I feel like it's necessary too because of what happened 2 weeks ago, and it came straight from the heart. And that's kind of what I hope to kind of continue on and be able to do within WWE is
yeah.
Dana's a character. Dana's an outer shell, you know?
Right. But
my heart's always going to be Ashley.
Yeah. And Ashley, literally, that's what you have to do. You said it, you've got nothing to lose. You need to try this angle. Just be you. I always mm-hmm. end my podcast saying, remember to always be yourself and trust that it's enough.
Yeah.
So and you just have to be yourself and trust that it's enough, seriously, because you are enough. And it is when you take off all those layers of makeup and you take off all the, you know, the hoopla and the this, and you sit down and just be you.
That's wow. exactly what I'm doing.
Seriously, that's when people can connect. And I don't even know that you could have even done this interview had we done it before. Had I said, yeah, let's have you on, it would have still been Dana, you know, as far as Dana Brooke doing the interview and not Ashley. And I wanted Ashley on here. So
and
I want to thank you. Yeah, I love
thank
that.
Thank you. Thank you.
I always ask this at the end, and I pretty much know the answer, but I want to give you the opportunity. Has your chase for glory looked the way you thought it was going to look?
You know, it's been through different paths and different journeys and different roads, dark times, but it's always gonna, I have one goal in life and it will never steer me no matter which path it's leading in. I will always find my way and I will always chase my glory and make sure that I'll never give up.
I love that. How do we find you on social media?
You can find me on social media. Again, I'm trying to keep it as real as possible. So I use my Instagram as Asha, A-S-H-A, Sebera, S-E-B-E-R-A, underscore Dana Brooke. That's my Instagram. Twitter is just Dana Brooke, and I don't have a Facebook.
Sorry, most people don't.
Yeah. So that's where you can find me.
That's awesome. Thank you. I wish you the continued success. Thank you so much for sharing your story. And I can't wait to see where this leads. I mean,
thank you.
Look, no matter what, where this storyline ends, I would assume that you're at least going to be in the Battle Royal at WrestleMania.
Listen, as far as I'm concerned, I can fight with one arm. Doesn't matter. It's not going to keep me down. I'm going to keep going and, you know, try and come back and win that battle royal.
That's awesome. So let's hope this is going to be an amazing rest of the year for you. I can already tell. So again, thank you for being on Chasing Glory and I love you dearly.
Yeah. One more thing though. I want to make sure that everybody knows, like, I don't want this to be a sob story or anything like this, but this has truly made me who I am. I'm so grateful for every opportunity that I'm given. And I always turn a negative into a positive. No matter what life throws at you, always turn a negative into a positive.
I love that. And you know what? The silver lining with you not having gymnastics in your life is that you became a WWE superstar.
Yep, so
there's totally. Always silver linings to everything.
Exactly.
I love it.
Thank you.
All
right.
Chasing Glory with Lilian Garcia.
What a Chasing Glory story. So many lessons in that interview. Wow, Dana, thank you so much for being so vulnerable and being so open and sharing things that you've never shared before. And I'm so sorry, like the loss of your ex-boyfriend, I know had to be so hard to speak about, but I thank you because it does share the journey that you've been on and the struggles and the dark places and how you've been able to overcome that, because there's a lot of us that have had loss in our lives. And you unfortunately lost someone way too early. And that, I don't know what that feels like. And somebody you're so close to at that age, for sure. Because the loss of my father, I know, was a lot later in life. But yeah, just wanted to clear, by the way, afterwards, she let me know, because I was asking her, there were so many rumors as to why Dallas passed away and what happened to her. And he had genetic heart failure. It is a genetic thing that was in the family. And also, he was on the onset of a thyroid cancer. So they said had he lived from the heart, he still would have had to deal with thyroid cancer. So let me tell you, at 26 years old, he was battling a lot. God rest his soul. But I'm really happy that she's been able to find somebody new in her life. I got to actually meet Ennis afterwards. He came on the screen. Really great guy. Really, really super nice guy. So I'm really happy for Dana. And I can't wait to see what continues to happen to her in the WWE. And thank you guys for following her, for inspiring her, for keeping her going. Like she said, it was you guys too that really, really did help. It makes a big difference. We're all in this together and it feels good to cheer somebody on, right? Be the cheerleader and then be okay to also receive somebody cheering for you. So it works both ways. Thank you so much, Dana. And for now, just want to thank you guys again for following the show at Chasing Glory Podcast on Instagram, at Lilian Garcia on Instagram and Twitter and Lilian Garcia official fan page on Facebook, also youtube.com/Lilian Garcia, the Chasing Glory app, all the different places you can get Chasing Glory. Thank you to for subscribing to the show, for reviewing the show. Keep those reviews coming so that you can enter the contest, and also for the 5-star rating. Really appreciate it. Until next week, guys, remember to go out there and live with much peace, love, and passion as we're on the road to WrestleMania. So exciting. All right. And remember to always be yourself and trust that it's enough. Love you. Bye.
Thanks for joining us here on Chasing Glory from executive producer Lilian Garcia. Don't forget to share this episode with your friends and be sure to subscribe at Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your favorite shows. Hey.